Joining us now, Joe diGenova, legal analyst, former U.S. attorney to the District of Columbia. Joe, good morning.
Good morning.
All right, the president with the Ukraine. There's a big deal about this. The Democrats are giving the president until Thursday to declassify the report on that phone call with the president of the Ukraine, President Zelensky. Should the president give them what they want?
No. There's no reason to declassify that call. The Democrats are attempting to interfere in the conduct of foreign policy, which is reserved under Article 2 to the President of the United States. This is Russia hoax 2.0. What they are doing is creating a false crisis about nothing in order to regenerate interest in another theme to get the discussion away from the stuff that's coming out about FISA and the Russia hoax and the role that Hillary Clinton and played with Christopher Steele and others. So I don't expect them to declassify, the White House to declassify anything.
So that's a pretty specific distraction effort they'd be undertaking. Why do you believe that the two things are so intertwined?
Which two things?
That this scandal about Ukraine and a phone call that's being created in the media is coming just before we get an IG report out about the behavior of the Obama administration. Why are those things intertwined in your view?
Well, I think they're self-evident. I think a distraction is always needed when trouble is coming, and that's what this is. This is a manufactured crisis, unlike the Mexican border situation. So this is just another example of the way the media works hand in glove with the Democrats to try to undo this president. And he's been pretty strong, and he's standing up to it, and I don't expect them to cave on this. I mean, it's pretty obvious what they're doing.
Well, one of the key points here, the person who's the centerpiece of this is some sort of anonymous figure who's being called a whistleblower from, I guess, inside the intelligence community. And that would lend credence to what you're saying, that there are people that do not want this type of exposure.
Well, let's remember, first of all, this person is called a whistleblower.
Right.
But in fact, he does not meet the definition of a whistleblower. Second, we do not know where he works in the bureaucracy. He or she has not been identified. We don't know if this person works at State, Justice, CIA, FBI, who knows? What's interesting about this is that the Inspector General, Michael Atkinson, who reported this so-called whistleblower report to the House Intelligence Committee, used to work for John Carlin, who was the Assistant Attorney General for the National Security Division when all of the false FISA applications were involved with Carter Page. This is a fascinating story about the merry-go-round in Washington. This guy, Michael Atkinson, the IG for the intelligence community, I want to know more about him. But I really want to know about this whistleblower. Where does he or she work? How long have they been there?
Yes.
Are they active in Democratic politics? There's all kinds of things I want to know about this person. So I hope he becomes publicly, he or she is publicly exposed.
But we do know that he or she did not have firsthand knowledge of this.
Yes, this is triple hearsay, apparently. And this person, then it's pretty obvious, but by the way this was reported in July to the IG, to the Inspector General, that this is a setup. This person is reporting something he or she heard about, and all of a sudden it becomes a matter of, quote, urgent concern under the statute to be reported to the IG. That is utter nonsense. This is a fabricated crisis, and it should be treated that way by the White House. By the way, that doesn't mean that the Democrats are not going to scream impeachment about this. You've seen over the weekend that Nancy Pelosi sent out a letter that this phone call comes close to the kind of lawlessness that might push her over the edge. This is quite a development that she sent that letter out yesterday to everybody in the House of Representatives about this phone call. She sees this as an opportunity, and she's not going to miss it.
But to your point, we now know, according to Susan Ferriccio, she put together somewhat of a timeline. Adam Schiff ordered an investigation into a wide-ranging investigation into allegations that the president was trying to pressure the Ukraine government into aiding his reelection campaign. But Schiff ordered the investigation on September 9th, which hours before he received the first of two letters from Inspector General Michael Atkinson revealing the existence of the complaint.
Right.
And the letter didn't provide Schiff with the details. So Schiff knew ahead of time.
Yes, somebody already leaked this information to Adam Schiff, and that is why this is part of a scheme to regenerate Russia hoax 2. It's fairly obvious that the new, instead of Robert Mueller, it's going to be the House Intelligence Committee that's going to play that role. And they're going to have this faux investigation into this whistleblower. And believe me, this is what happens when power changes hands in one chamber of the Congress.
Right.
So they have the power to do this, and they're going to do it. And it's going to be ugly, and it's going to get very nasty.
But I wonder, Joe, if this is not blowing up in the Democratic Party's face already, because we look at the idea here, in order to report on this story, you have to at least glance off the fact that Joe Biden's family has corrupt entanglements in both Ukraine and China, to say the least. And to talk about those stories is not a good thing for Joe Biden.
They're willing to sacrifice Joe. Joe is expendable at this point as far as the Democrats are concerned. They're happy to get rid of him. And so if he has to be sacrificed in order to attack the president, they will do that. The truth is that the Biden family used Air Force Two and the trappings of the vice presidency to extort money from foreign governments to get contracts over $1 billion in investment money from China. When Hunter Biden goes on Air Force Two with the vice president to China, and while he's there, Hunter Biden secures a $1 billion investment from a Chinese government-backed businesses. I mean, this is outrageous. If this were Trump and his family doing something like this, there'd be editorials, there'd be everything. And yet, according to the Democrats and the mainstream media, there's no there. But you're absolutely right. This has drawn attention to the corrupt dealings of Joe Biden and his son Hunter. And I'm sure there's going to be more that comes out now about these dealings of Hunter Biden and who he worked with and how they got the case dropped against him. Remember, central to this whole issue is Joe Biden on tape bragging about how he got the prosecutor fired who was investigating his son. I'm sure he thought that no one would ever, you know, think about this or put two and two together. But it's pretty obvious that Joe Biden did what they are accusing President Trump of. He strong-armed the Ukrainian government officials to drop a case against his son in exchange for him authorizing the $1.2 billion loan guarantee. And by the way, he did so with the authority of President Obama. Obama was aware that this shakedown was going on with the Ukrainians. So, by all means, let's dig into this,
and
let's really dig into it.
Yeah, if this was Trump's scandal, they'd have a basis for impeachment. More on that in a moment, because Nancy Pelosi has some agenda items this week. I want to ask Joe diGenova about those. But
Joe, Nancy Pelosi now is floating the idea of changing the law that would allow for a sitting president to be indicted. She said they have to have some clarity for future presidents. A president should be indicted if he's committed a wrongdoing, any president. Is this actually a law? I thought this was just something that was kind of like something that they've always done, that you don't go after a sitting president, that the DOJ does not do that. I thought that was a rule more so than a law.
Well, there is an opinion, two opinions actually, by what's called the Office of Legal Counsel in the Department of Justice. That is the office which is basically the lawyer for the United States government. They advise all agencies, including the White House, what the law is. And they tell them what can happen. In both in the 1970s under Nixon and in the 1990s under Clinton, the Office of Legal Counsel issued two opinions. And in both of those opinions, they said that a sitting president cannot be indicted. They gave a list of reasons, both constitutional and policy reasons and common sense reasons, basically that you can't have a president under assault, otherwise he cannot fulfill his functions. And that that is the law. In fact, absent a Supreme Court opinion on this subject, the Office of Legal Counsel is the law in the United States because it's the enforcement law. So Ms. Pelosi is simply wrong. The guiding legal opinion for the United States government is two opinions, one in the Clinton administration and one in the Nixon administration, would say a sitting president cannot be indicted. Now, if they were to pass a law to say you can indict a president while he's in office, that would be subject to legal challenge. And my guess is that it would be struck down by the Supreme Court. But we'll see.
Now,
never get through the Senate as long as it's controlled by Republicans.
Right,
we'll
right. Now, Joe, the Constitution has a prescription for how to indict a sitting president. It's to impeach them, right?
Yes. The impeachment process is there specifically for executive branch and judicial officials to be removed from office through the impeachment process. And, in fact, the two Office of Legal Counsel opinions go into that in great detail, that is the appropriate remedy, not an indictment of a president. Now, other officials can be indicted, like federal judges who have been, like Alcee Hastings, for example, who's now a member of Congress. He was indicted while he was a sitting federal
yes.
judge. So all sorts of executive branch officials can be indicted.
Mm-hmm.
But the president cannot because he is a constitutional officer. He is the executive branch under Article II. And so the Office of Legal Counsel has determined that an indictment of a sitting president is too disruptive and unnecessary to have accountability and that you have impeachment if you got a problem.
So, Joe, as far as all of this goes, it seems like we're talking to you every single week about a new quote-unquote scandal involving the president with the left ratcheting up the rhetoric. Are we going to see Nancy Pelosi just finally agree to a call for impeachment? AOC over the weekend was putting pressure on her for this. Are they going to hit a boiling point where it's going to be, look, do it or shut up?
Well, I think the letter that Nancy Pelosi sent yesterday to all the members of the House raising serious concerns about the phone call and everything was a new period in her trying to deal with her left-wing, Nazi, semi-communist part of her caucus on the left. And that may be her beginning to break under the pressure of impeachment. We shall see. We'll see what happens.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting, and I'm sure we will have you with us to guide us through it legally and to comment on it. We always look forward to it. Joe, thank you so much.
You bet.